BBC Audio presents The Poetry of History, where Sir Jonathan Bate examines 8 iconic poems inspired by great historical events.
I have met them at close of day, coming with vivid faces from counter or desk among grey 18th century houses.
It is close of day, and I am among grey 18th century houses as Dubliners throng from their work, just as W.B. Yeats imagined himself at the beginning of his poem, Easter 1916. It's a very ordinary city scene, but one that was transformed, transfigured, by an event so dramatic it would inspire the best known lines of any poem written in English in the 20th century.
All changed. Changed utterly. A terrible beauty is born.
That event was the Easter Rising, and the profound impact it had on the history of Ireland and its culture is still being felt today. My taxi driver on the way in from the airport was eloquent on the subject. 90 years is no time in the perspective of history, he said. This is the first of 4 programmes in which I'll be looking at major historical events through the poetry that was written in response to them. Poetry is not history, but it can achieve a kind of historical truth. W.H. Auden, in his poem written in memory of W.B. Yeats, said that poetry makes nothing happen. Well, maybe not at the time, but in the long term, a poem like Easter 1916 can profoundly shape how we regard historical events. I'll be exploring this with Dermot Ferriter, author of The Transformation of Ireland, 1900 to 2000, a huge work of historical synthesis, some 900 pages long, and to discuss the many-dimensioned quality of Yeats, we'll be talking to the RTE broadcaster, himself a poet, Theo Dorgan, and we'll also be joined later by the novelist Anne Enright. But first, let's set the scene. Dermot, what was it that happened to change everything utterly?
Well, the Easter Rising began on Easter Monday in 1916 when in the region of 1,600 Irish men and women declared war on the British Empire on the streets of Dublin and declared an Irish Republic. They've been referred to sometimes as a Legion of the Excluded. They incorporated many different small groups, people who had been involved in the Cultural Revival, poets, teachers, those involved in some of the secret revolutionary societies such as the Irish Republican Brotherhood, those involved in Labour and Socialist politics, members of the Irish Citizens Army as well. What they did was not just important in the context of the evolution of Irish politics, but also a challenge to the British Empire during the First World War. It was very much a minority event, and it was something that caused a lot of surprise and consternation.
And Theo, what was the relationship of W.B. Yeats to these people?
Yeats had spent the previous 15 to 20 years of his life trying to imagine a new Ireland into being. He would have known a number of the participants, so there must have been a sense of personal affront when he discovered not only that this had happened, but that they'd known about it in advance and hadn't told him. So there was a certain amount of nose out of joint about it all.
So what these people did on Easter Monday 1916 was to seize a number of key buildings in Dublin city centre. They had their headquarters at the General Post Office on O'Connell Street, and they effectively were challenging the British military to respond. They held out the insurgents for about a week before there was an unconditional surrender at the end of that week.
So Yeats begins his poem by saying that he's known some of these people, he's just seen them going about their daily business, but something extraordinary happens, something changes as a result of this event.
I have met them at close of day, coming with vivid faces from counter or desk among grey 18th century houses. I've passed with a nod of the head, or polite, meaningless words, or have lingered a while and said polite, meaningless words, and thought before I had done of a mocking tale or a jibe to please a companion around the fire at the club, being certain that they and I but lived where motley is worn. All changed, changed utterly. A terrible beauty is born.
On Orisha, Frodigsha, and the Forsi, a Yarvik Fui Anam, Kyarth Neheran Connoisseurship.
We've walked into the General Post Office, and the first thing you see in front of you is a black tablet on the wall reading, "Here on Easter Monday 1916, Patrick Pearse read the proclamation of the Irish Republic." From this building, he commanded the forces that asserted in arms Ireland's right to freedom. We've come up to the balcony, looking down on the floor of the General Post Office as people queue up to buy their stamps. So is this the place where the terrible beauty was born? Dermot Ferriter, how many people actually occupied the post office?
Well, that's a matter of debate. Certainly not as many people who later claimed they were here. The original plan was for a garrison of 150 people to be in this building. Now, during the week, the GPO actually acted as a kind of a magnet for all sorts of latecomers. So there were just over 400 people here throughout the duration of Easter week 1916.
And the siege came to an end with what, sort of heavy artillery or a storming?
There was heavy artillery, there was also a lot of sniping going on as well. Pierce had decided eventually that to prevent the further slaughter of innocent people that he would have to surrender unconditionally, and he actually sent a nurse, Elizabeth Farrell, to give over this note of surrender.
Theodorgan, it's a very atmospheric place, but do you think, as an Irishman, that buying a stamp here is somehow different from buying a stamp anywhere else? Is that resonance of history still in the building?
Nowadays, when you make a revolution, the first thing you do, you seize the television station. Seizing the GPO was not, in that sense, accidental, because it was a nexus of communication. I like the building particularly now because it's a crossroads of the New Republic. If we look down here from the balcony, you see Lithuanians, Poles, Ghanaians, Nigerians, Russians, all the new Irish busy wrapping up things and sending them to all corners of the world.
We've been joined here by writer Anne Enright. Anne, was the post office and the events of Easter 1916 part of the iconography of what it meant to be Irish for you as you grew up?
We lived beside a veteran of 1916, a guy called Blimey O'Connor, who came across from England with a lovely Cockney accent. He was a very nice guy, and he ran the shortwave radio, either on the top of Cleary's or around in Abbey Street. But it wasn't a passionate concern until it became an uncomfortable concern, which was when the civil unrest in Northern Ireland became violent. During the time of the Troubles in the North, 1916 became a problem, because whoever owns 1916 owns Irish history. And whoever owns it, it ain't me, because I come from a different, more non-violent tradition. The Irish government has always tried to manage a balance between not becoming like the Brits in our attitude to our history and honouring it in some way. This year we're going to have a military parade. Yippee! I love the idea of armoured cars going up O'Connell Street. I love the idea. Going out to buy your pint of milk.
Dermot, sometimes an occupation of a public building such as this is the spark that ignites a revolution across a country, but that didn't happen on this occasion, did it?
We can't talk about the ordinary people of Dublin and Ireland embracing the idea of 1916. That happened at a slightly later stage.
I was very interested in the rising at school, and all my granny could tell me was that she couldn't get into Cleary's to buy her vests. You still get a good vest in Cleary's, and I don't know if I'd, you know, want to cross gunfire to buy them.
It was an event that in itself would not have transformed Ireland but for the reaction to it on the part of the British government. The fact in particular that they decided to abandon politics in Ireland, to send in General Maxwell to suppress the rising, and that militarisation made the Irish people much more militant and made them, of course, cling to this event. The very fact that words had been replaced by action and the idea that the future would now belong to action and armed action.
Now, Yeats wasn't here himself in the post office, but in the second stanza of the poem, he begins to talk about some of the people who were, although, to begin with, he doesn't actually name their names.
That woman's days were spent in ignorant goodwill, her nights in argument, until her voice grew shrill. What voice more sweet than hers, when young and beautiful, she rode to harriers? This man had kept a school and rode our winged horse. This other, his helper and friend, was coming into his force. He might have won fame in the end, so sensitive his nature seemed, so daring and sweet his thought. This other man I had dreamed, a drunken, vainglorious lout. He had done most bitter wrong to some who are near my heart. Yet I number him in the song. He too has resigned his part in the casual comedy. He too has been changed in his turn, transformed utterly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.